Hello students, today we shall be discussing the radioactive successive transformations and the radioactive equilibrium. So in the previous lecture we had discussed something about the radioactive series. As you know that there are four types of radioactive series, that is thorium series, neptunium series, actinium series, like that. That was having the mass number of A equal to 4N, where mass number could be A equal to 4N plus 1 or 4N plus 2 or 4N plus 3. So what did you see in that series? That the parent nucleus disintegrated into the daughter nucleus. Before it ended up forming a stable daughter nucleus, it had successive daughter nucleus in its transitions. So in the successive daughter nucleus transformations, what is that? That before ending up into the stable daughter nucleus, there are many more daughter nucleus in between the path, and these daughter nucleus have a short lifetime, very much as compared to the parent nucleus or the stable end product of the daughter nucleus. Supposingly we say that at time t equal to 0, at initial time, that they let the number of atoms in the parent substance be n naught. So if at any instant we want to consider, supposingly we have that the first is disintegrating, emitting some particle, becoming second daughter nucleus, then second is disintegrating to form third daughter nucleus, then fourth, then fifth, and so on to nth. This nth is the final daughter nucleus. So we suppose at any instant t, what is the number of atoms at that time, at that moment of time of the first parent nucleus? So n1 is the number of atoms of the first element in the series, n2 is the number of atoms of the second element in the series, n3 is the number of atoms of the third element in the series of the radioactive transition series, and so on. And likewise we also say that like the first element has the radioactive constant or the decay constant as lambda 1, second is having a decay constant of lambda 2, third is having a decay constant of lambda 3, and so on. So at time t equal to 0, we had the number of atoms in the parent substance equal to n naught, and at time t, the parent substance itself is having the number of atoms n1, where some of the atoms has disintegrated to form some successive daughter nucleus. So all these elements will obey the exponential decay law. So what was the exponential decay law? Exponential decay law, you all know that it is n is equal to n naught e to the power minus lambda t. So if for we want to calculate for the first, it would be n1 is equal to n naught e to the power minus lambda 1 t. If you want to calculate for the second, it would be n2 is equal to n1, because initially what is it? n1. So n1 e to the power minus lambda 2 t. So now for this, we calculate what? The rate of decay. At what time, how much is the decay possible? So the rate of decay is nothing but calculated by dN by dt. So when we differentiate this equation, what we get? dN by dt is equal to n naught, which is constant. So this part will be differentiated with respect to time. We get minus lambda e to the power minus lambda t. So this n naught e to the power minus lambda t can be substituted as n. So we get dn by dt is equal to n times minus lambda. So what we get? dn by dt is equal to minus lambda n. So if we want to write the rate of decay for the first element, so rate of decay of the first element will be what? Just by replacing n by n1, lambda by lambda 1. We get dn1 by dt is equal to minus lambda 1 n1. So what we say here, that the first element is decaying to form the second element. So there would be a rise in the second element, and simultaneously the second element would decay to form the third element. So there are two changes happening in element number 2. First, there is an increase in its number due to the decay of the element 1, and there is a decrease in its number due to the decay of the same element to form a successive daughter nucleus. So the number of atoms of the second element increases at the rate at which the first element is decaying. So the rate of decay was minus lambda 1 n 1. But since it is increasing, the second element is increasing, the rate is increasing. So the negative sign has been changed to positive sign. So the number of atoms of second element increases at this rate, which is lambda 1 n 1. And since it is decaying to form another daughter nucleus, at the same time it is decreasing at the rate, it will again decrease at the same rate, just by substituting n by n2 and lambda by lambda 2. So it would decrease at the rate of lambda 2 n2 per second. And obviously there would be a negative sign because it is decaying. So the rate of decay of the second element will be given by, or we can say the net rate will be dN2 by dt will be lambda 1 N1 minus lambda 2 N2. So one question arises in your mind, why there is a word coming decay? Why it is not a rise? Because what is happening here? That 2 is decaying into 3. It is not here that 2 is rising, the number of 2 is rising. They are short-lived, they would not remain in its position. They would simultaneously decay to form third will decay to form fourth will decay to form fifth. Because they are in the process of decaying. That is why there is a word decay. So we say that the rate of decay of the second element is nothing but lambda 1 n1 minus lambda 2 n2. Since the decay is what is there, obviously this lambda 2 n2 would be larger in the quantity than lambda 1 n1. If this lambda 1 n1 term is there, so the rise will be there instead of decay. So similarly, as we wrote for n2, second particle and second element, we can write it for the third element, fourth element and so on. So writing it for the third element of the series, dn3 by dt will be lambda 2 n2 minus lambda 3 n3. And the rate of decay of the fourth element would be lambda 3 n3 minus lambda 4 n4. Similarly, for the nth particle, if we want to calculate nth element, we want to calculate, it could be written as lambda n minus 1 n n minus 1 minus lambda n n n. So this process of decaying will continue till we get a stable end product or the stable daughter nucleus. Supposing this is our stable daughter nucleus, the process will continue till we reach up to this nth element of the series, that is the nth stable product. So what happens? What we see that this process is continuing. Something is decaying, someone is rising, some number is decaying, some number is rising. So what will happen then? That there would be some equilibrium maintained in the process. So what does the equilibrium mean? Equilibrium means some settling there is taking place. So settlement means that what will happen? That the rate at which this second atom, second element would be formed would be equal to the rate at which it would be decaying. So there would be a balance when the rate of decay is equal to rate of its rise. So that is meaning of the radioactive equilibrium. So at equilibrium, always the rate of change of the function is equal to zero. So the rate of change of function is zero. So in radioactive decay, the intermediate members, which are the intermediate members? These 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 are the intermediate daughter nucleus. So the intermediate member of each decay has much smaller lifetime as compared to the parent nuclei. So since it is having a much smaller lifetime, so the equilibrium will be maintained. And what is the equilibrium condition there? That the rate at which the daughter nucleus decays, at which the daughter nucleus is decaying, supposing the 2 is decaying to form 3. So the rate of decay would be equal to the rate of its formation. So each daughter nucleus decays with the same rate at which the daughter nucleus was formed. So at that state, when this state is reached, when the rates are equal of the decay and the formation, we say that the state of radioactive equilibrium has been attained. So now if we suppose that we take the equation that this dN2 by dt is equal to lambda 1 N1 minus lambda 2 N2, and we know that this N1 can be written as n1 can be written as n naught e to the power minus lambda 1 t. So what will be dn2 by dt? So dn2 by dt will be lambda 1 n naught e to the power minus lambda 1 t minus of lambda 2 n2. So this is how we get this equation. So now what you have to do? You multiply this equation by e to the power lambda 2t on both the sides. So taking e to the power lambda 2t on both the sides, we get this equation. And we take all the terms with the two number subscript on one side. So we get e to the power lambda 2t dn2 by dt plus lambda 2 n2 e to the power lambda 2t, which is equal to e to the power lambda 2 t e to the power minus lambda 1 t n naught into lambda 1. So what we are left out with here? So this is what? This is the perfect differential d by dt of e to the power lambda 2 t into n2. That is, we have to apply the chain rule. So when we take the differential of the first and the second function, uv function, first this function will be differentiated keeping this as constant, and then keeping this as constant, then we will differentiate to second function. So we get the same equation. So this can be written as this, that it is the perfect differential of the term e to the power lambda 2t into n2. And this can be written as e to the power lambda 2 minus lambda 1 into t into n naught into lambda 1. Now what we have to do? Take the integration on both the sides. So on integrating both the sides, we get e to the power lambda 2 t n2, which is equal to n naught lambda 1. So this is constant, it comes out of the integral, and it is e to the power lambda 2 minus lambda 1, and the differential integration is carried over the t variable, so it is e to the power lambda 2 minus lambda 1 and a constant of integration. So this is the term that you get, that is n2 e to the power lambda 2t is equal to lambda 1 n0 e to the power lambda 2 minus lambda 1t upon lambda 2 minus lambda 1 plus a constant of integration. So now we have to calculate this constant of integration. So how will we calculate the value of constant of integration? So always the constant of integration are calculated by the initial value points. So when we substitute at time t equal to 0, what was at time t equal to 0? At time t equal to 0, only the first element was present with its initial number of atoms, that was n naught. So, and since it was only the n naught present, there was no second daughter nucleus formed. So the number of particle of the second element is 0. So at t equal to 0, n2 equal to 0. So when we substitute n2 equal to 0 in this equation, so n2 equal to 0 means here the left hand side is equal to 0, and putting t equal to 0, e exponential raised to power 0 is 1. So what we are left out with? We get 0 is equal to n naught lambda 1 upon lambda 2 minus lambda 1 plus c. So c comes out nothing but c is equal to minus n naught lambda 1 upon lambda 2 minus lambda 1. So this is the value of constant of integration. Now we substitute the value of constant of integration in the equation number A. So on substituting the value of C in this equation, you get n2 e to the power lambda 2t is equal to lambda 1 n0 e to the power lambda 2 minus lambda 1 t upon lambda 2 minus lambda 1 minus n0 lambda 1 upon lambda 2 minus lambda 1. So now these terms can be just simplified. So we get n2 is equal to lambda 1 n0 e to the power lambda 2 minus lambda 1 lambda 2t upon e to the power lambda 2t minus e to the power minus lambda 1t upon e to the power lambda 2t. Sorry, this is a multiply sign here. And minus n naught lambda 1 upon lambda 2 minus lambda 1 into e to the power minus lambda 2t. So either e to the power lambda 2t, lambda 2t gets cancelled. So we get lambda 1 n naught upon lambda 2 minus lambda 1 gets common and is taken out of the bracket and leading here to the formation of e to the power minus lambda 1 t minus e to the power, here it is a positive sign, so it is minus of lambda 2 t. So you can see that we have arrived to the equation number C. So n2 is nothing but lambda 1 n naught lambda 2 minus lambda 1 e to the power minus lambda 1 t minus of e to the power minus lambda 2 t. So now if we plot a graph between the relative number of the nucleides of element 1 and 2 changing with time, so what type of graph we observe? So on the y-axis we have number of atom and on the x-axis we have the time scale. So we know that initially when time t is equal to 0, the second element had not appeared into the discussion. There was only the first that were having the initial number of atom to be n naught. So at t equal to 0, the first element was having the atoms n naught and the second element was having 0 number of atoms. So with the advancement of time, what happened that the first element started decreasing or decaying and the second element started increasing. So at this particular time, the rate at which the second is formed is equal to the rate at which the first was disappearing. So after that, what happens? The rate is for the first element is again decaying, but the second element is increasing. And at this time, when the first has completely decayed, the second element had risen to its maximum. And beyond that time, the decay of the second element also starts increasing. So this shows that how the number of atoms of the first element and the second element is changing with respect to time. So now we have the change in the number of atoms. We have number of atoms of the second element is n2, which is n0 lambda 1 upon lambda 2 minus lambda 1 e to the power minus lambda 1 t minus e to the power minus lambda 2 t c. This is the C equation. So now if we compare, if we take the condition that the half-life time of the first element is much greater than the half-life time of the second element. We already know that 1 is decaying into 2, 2 is decaying into 3, 3 is decaying into 4 and so on. So this is the parent and these are the successive daughter nucleus or the daughter nuclei or the daughter elements. So these daughter nuclei are to decay simultaneously. They are not to end up as a stable end product. So naturally the half-life time of this second is quite less than the half-life time of the parent nuclei. So that is why the half-life time of the parent is quite high than the half-life time of the daughter nucleus. So if T half is given by 0.693 upon lambda, that is the decay constant. If the half-life time is more, then the decay constant will be less. And if this is less, then the decay constant will be high. So that is why the half-life time of the parent was high. So the decay constant of the parent would be less as compared to the daughter nuclei. So if lambda 1 is less than lambda 2, so therefore lambda 2 minus lambda 1 would be nearly written as it is equal to lambda 2. So what we do, we make certain changes on our equation. So this lambda 2 minus lambda 1 is substituted as lambda 2. You can see here that n2 is equal to lambda 1 n0 upon lambda 2, where we have made a supposition that lambda 2 minus lambda 1 is nearly equal to lambda 2. And since the half-life time of the first is very very greater than the half-life time of the daughter nucleus, so and the decay constant lambda 1 is less than lambda 2, so lambda 1 is nearly taken to be equal to 0. So when we take lambda 1 to be 0, anything raised to power 0, positive or negative, it is always equal to 1. So in this expression, for here in this expression, what we get e to the power minus 0 t, so we get it equal to 1. So n2 is nothing but n2 is lambda 1 n0 upon lambda 2 lambda 1 is substituted to be 0. So this is equal to 1. So we get 1 minus e to the power minus lambda 2t. So this is the expression of N2, where we consider that the half-life time of the parent is quite high than the half-life time of the daughter, where the decay constant of the parent is negligible or 0 and compared to the decay constant of the daughter nucleus. Now if we suppose that after time t, after sufficient time t has passed away, since the half-life time of the parent is quite high than the half-life time of the daughter, so when we take the relative term of the time, so what will happen, that relative to the time, the when we take this, so the time for the second will be quite small and the time for the parent would be quite high. If the time for the parent is quite high, so if the time for the parent is quite high, the decay constant would be obviously equal to quite less. So when we are taking a relative notion, supposingly I make you understand this. Supposingly that two trains are passing along the same path. They are traveling at the same speed. So what does it mean? It seems that the two rails are not moving at all. So the speed is relatively taken to be equal to 0, or we are supposed to be standing at a still position or rest position. But if they are crossing at opposite direction, so it means that it seems that the speed of the trains have increased by its original speed by a double. So relative term is something like that. So when we say after a long time t, long relative to the t half, so long relative to t half means it seems that the second has passed enough of its time. This means that its half-life time would be small. That is why it seems that most of the time of the second daughter nucleus has been passed. But it remains shorter to the half-life time of the first, that is the parent nuclei, because the parent has enough quite long time. So if some portion of the time has passed for the parent also, then also it seems that some only little time of the parent has passed. But for the daughter nucleus, it seems that quite a lot of time has been passed. So in that case, what would happen? That in that case, the lambda 2, that is the decay constant of the daughter nucleus, would be quite high. As I told, for this, the t half will be small for the daughter nucleus. So if t half is small, this means the lambda 2 will be large. So if lambda 2 is large, so e ki power minus lambda 2t, it is quite large. Lambda 2 is large. So this means 1 upon e to the power lambda 2t. So this is a large value. So this means 1 upon some large value. So 1 upon some large value means it is a small value. And this small value is quite less than 1, which can be neglected in comparison to 1. And since this term is 0 and it is having a quite a small lifetime, so therefore that means that the original number of atoms that were present at time t would be equal to the initial number of atoms of the parent nuclei. So n1 can be substituted as n0. So n0 is substituted as n1, and here this quantity is negligible, is taken as to be 0. So what we get? We get n2 is equal to n1 lambda 1 upon lambda 2 into 1 minus 0. So this is nothing but n2 lambda 2 is equal to n1 lambda 1. So I think I have made you clear that n1 lambda 1 is equal to n2 lambda 2. Similar calculations can be performed for the second and third and fourth and fifth. So these can be extended to the number of terms. So what we will get? That n1 lambda 1 is equal to n2 lambda 2 is equal to n3 lambda 3 and so on. So if this type of equilibrium is maintained between the elements of the successive transformations, so we say that the daughter nucleus are in secular equilibrium with each other. This means that the daughter nucleus are in the state of what equilibrium? It is in the state of secular equilibrium. They are in the equal equilibrium, where n1 rate of formation, activity period, n1 lambda 1 is equal to n2 lambda 2. They all daughter nucleus are having the same activity, because activity R was equal to lambda into n. So all the daughter nucleus having the same activity. So n1 lambda n is equal to n2 lambda 2 is equal to n3 lambda 3 means that all the daughter nucleus are in the secular equilibrium with the parent element also. So now if we consider another case, where in the first case we had neglected that this lambda 1 is quite smaller than lambda 2 and its value was taken to be equal to 0. But we here consider that the value of lambda 1 is small, but it cannot be neglected. That lambda 1 is obviously smaller than lambda 2, but lambda 1 term cannot be neglected, it cannot be taken to be equal to 0. So this means that if this is taken to be, this can not taken to be equal to 0, so this term will not be equal to 1, as we case took it in the case here, that this is 0, so this comes out to be 1. So we have to take this contribution, but when we take this contribution, what happens, that since this lambda 2 is quite large, as I have explained earlier, e to the power minus lambda 2 is this, and lambda 2 is large value. So this means 1 upon e to the power lambda 2 is large. So this means 1 upon some larger value. So this means some smaller value. So since this is having a smaller value, let us take this small value as 0 in this case. So now we eliminate this term in this equation. So we take that this term is taken to be negligible. So what we have arrived here now? So in this case, what will be there? That n2. So n2 will be equal to n0 lambda 1 upon lambda 2 minus lambda 1, where in that case we had substituted lambda 2 minus lambda 1 equal to lambda 2. So but now we have to retain this lambda 2 minus lambda 1 term. And here we have e to the power lambda 1 t, because lambda 1 t cannot be neglected, we have taken. But the lambda 2 is quite like, we have neglected e to the power lambda 2 because it would be small contribution. So n2 would be represented as this, or we can say n2, and we can say now this n0 e to the power minus lambda 1 t is nothing but n1. So it is n1 lambda 1 upon lambda 2 minus lambda 1. I think you remember this term in the decay law, that n1 is n0 e to the power minus lambda 1 t. So for n0 e to the power minus lambda 1 t, we have substituted n1. So what we get? We get n2 is equal to this, or we can say that n2 upon n1 is equal to lambda 1 upon lambda 2 minus lambda 1. So this is what? This is the ratio. So this is the ratio of the number of atoms of the second element versus the first element. And this is equal to the ratio of the decay constant, that is lambda 1 upon lambda 2 minus lambda 1. So since lambda 1, lambda 2 minus lambda 1 are constant values, so what we say? We see here that the ratio of the number of atoms of the second element versus first element is a constant value. Okay, so n2 upon n1 is equal to lambda 1 upon lambda 2 minus lambda 1, which is constant. So when such type of terms come into our equation, where n2 by n1 is having a constant values, the daughter and parent nuclei decays with the period of parent, such type of equilibrium is regarded as the transient equilibrium. Okay, that is called the transient. But if we had n1 lambda 1 is equal to n2 lambda 2 and n3, we called that equilibrium as a state of secular equilibrium. But when the ratio of the number of atoms are constant or fixed, then we say that the terms in the successive transformation are having a transient equilibrium. So in this way, we can see how the daughter nucleus are changing, transforming to become the stable daughter nucleus. So I hope that you have understood the concept, that how the parent nuclei is disintegrating and emitting certain nuclei, certain elements, forming successive daughter nucleus, and the daughter nucleus is successively disintegrating to form the final stable daughter nucleus, that is a stable end product. So meet you soon again. Thank you.